Good morning. We have general questions. Question number one, Jo McAlpine.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what progress is being made by the independent expert scientific panel on unconventional oil and gas.
Minister Fergus Ewing.
The independent expert scientific panel was convened by the Scottish Government with a remit to review the scientific evidence on unconventional oil and gas and provide a report. The panel has met several times and is considering evidence from a variety of interested stakeholders covering planning, economics, geology and environmental issues.
Jo McAlpine.
The Minister will be aware of the concerns of my constituents in Canby, where permission to explore for coalbed methane was granted under delegated powers. My constituents are concerned that the makeup of the expert panel focuses too much on those with a background in petrochemicals and not enough on toxicology and indeed the impact of such developments on the community. Can the Minister offer any reassurances in this instance?
Minister.
I can reassure the member that the membership of the expert scientific panel was based upon recommendations made by the Chief Scientific Officer, Advisor, and the panel's expertise spans a breadth of disciplines in unconventional oil and gas, environmental, geological and engineering processes and resource extraction.
Andrew Fraser.
Thank you. The INEOS plant at Grangemouth is depending for its feedstock on US shale gas being shipped across the Atlantic in a fleet of tankers being constructed in China. Surely it would make much more sense in terms of the viability of that business and indeed its carbon footprint if it could instead depend upon a source of domestic unconventional gas, and the Scottish Government should be encouraging that.
Minister.
Well, I hear what the member says. I think so far as INEOS is concerned, it is a matter properly for the company to decide how they source their feedstocks, and they have, as I understand it, made a decision to proceed with the importation from the USA. And we note that. But of course, we take an evidence-based approach on all of these matters, and I think that's the correct approach. And we await in due course later this year the findings of the panel of experts, which includes experts and across a whole range of issues. And I think that evidence-based approach is one that the Scottish Conservatives adopted when they said that all new technologies must be evidence-led. I agree with the Conservatives in that respect.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. It seems that the problem is that the Energy Minister tends to regard all fossil fuels as an economic resource, while the Climate Change Minister accepts the global evidence that most fossil fuels must remain unused if we're going to have a chance of preventing catastrophic climate change. Is the government any closer to resolving this contradiction between its climate and energy policies?
Minister?
We don't accept that the contradiction exists.
Question number two, Sandra White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with stakeholders regarding the upgrade of Glasgow Queen Street Station.
Minister Keith Brown.
Transport Scotland, working with Network Rail, has had productive discussions with a number of stakeholders, which include First ScotRail, the Buchanan Partnership, the Millennium Copthorne Hotel, Glasgow City Council and Strathclyde Partnership for Transport. And we will continue to work closely with our key stakeholders as we progress the transformation of Queen Street Station.
Sandra White.
I thank the Minister for that reply. And the Minister will be aware of the announcement by Network Rail that Queen Street Station will be closed for 4 months. An announcement, which I may add, was not conveyed to Glasgow Chamber of Commerce or any local businesses. Can the Minister tell me what, if any, contingency plans have been made for users of Queen Street Station, and if there will be a consultation and who will be involved?
Minister.
I think it's important to be clear that the closure referred to by Network Rail is not part of the Egypt programme. Rather, it's related to the renewal of the existing trackbed in the Queen Street Tunnel. We would certainly want to have further discussions ourselves with Network Rail on that point. On disruption generally in and around Queen Street, a disruption management forum is to be convened by Transport Scotland involving stakeholders such as Glasgow City Council, SPT, Network Rail, First ScotRail and Passenger Focus. And that group will be tasked with looking at minimising the impact of any disruption to the travelling public, including Sandra White's constituents.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As has been already raised, Queen Street Station upper level will be closed for approximately 17 weeks, according to officials working on the project, as a result of replacement of that slab track. Can the Minister give an indication of the level of disruption passengers will likely experience in terms of journey time increases or service reduction, and also if the closure will coincide with the Winchborough Tunnel closure.
Minister.
I'm not sure if Mark Griffin heard my response to the second question from Sandra White, but I've just made clear that this referred closure by Network Rail is to do with their maintenance, not to do with the Egypt project. The project does not entail that closure. Well, if he's referring to the Egypt project and what disruption will happen as a result from that, then, as I've mentioned, there is a group looking at that, how best we can minimise that. Well, actually, I hear the member shout. I'm not sure what he's saying. I'm not entirely sure what the question was, if it wasn't about either the Egypt project and disruption or about the maintenance of the tunnels. All I can say is that these projects, and, of course, Egypt, is a £3 billion investment in infrastructure in Scotland, which will create many jobs and will dramatically improve the service that we can have. An investment that should have happened many years ago, it will necessarily create some disruption, and we will look to minimise that disruption by the measures which I've already stated.
Question 3, Jim Hume.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support rail travel in the South Scotland region.
Minister Keith Brown.
This Government is delivering substantial improvements to the rail network in the south of Scotland. We're investing £353 million in delivering the Borders Railway due in 2015, which will re-establish passenger services for the first time since 1969. We're also re-letting the £2.5 billion ScotRail franchise that aims to deliver faster and more efficient passenger services, which will strengthen connections between our cities and regions.
Jim Hume.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Minister will be aware of the campaign to have Beatuck rail station near Moffat reinstated. Does the Minister agree that a rail link to Beatuck and other stations in the south-west, such as Thornhill, East Riggs and Glenluce, would be a huge boost for tourism, local commuters and business? And does he support these four stations being reinstated? And would he agree to a short meeting with the Beatuck Station Action Group to hear about their plans?
Minister.
Well, I can say, I think, as the member is aware, that we have, within the re-letting the franchise which I've referred to, created a £30 million fund for the either improvement or the establishment of new stations, and that's the appropriate way for proposals to come forward for new stations. I have seen the representations in relation to Beatuck, and I'll continue to follow that, of course, but the fact that there's £2.5 billion going into a new franchise which will improve services and a subset of that £30 million for new stations really shows that we're addressing what Patrick McLaughlin recently conceded was decades of underinvestment in our transport infrastructure in Scotland in a way that's not been seen before.
John Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister and Transport Scotland officials have recently met with RailQuest, who are seeking to promote greater connectivity between Ayrshire and the south of Scotland with central and eastern Scotland, an aspiration I share, as it could also benefit the future of Prestwick Airport. Does the Minister now too share this aspiration? And if he does, how might this electrification project be taken forward?
Minister.
I was interested to meet RailQuest and listen to the points that they had made. I did make the point back to them that the way to take this forward, which is the point of John Scott's question, is really to take it to the Regional Transport Partnership or local authority in order to conduct a proper appraisal of that and so that it can then be properly considered. It was an interesting proposal. It doesn't quite do what some people imagine, which is connect the two main stations in Glasgow, as some people feel. But it is an interesting project. But the correct way to do it is to objectively assess it against the stack criteria. That's the way to take it forward.
Question 4, Gavin Brown.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to boost e-commerce.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has established a business excellence partnership to help Scottish businesses develop the confidence, capabilities and skills required to take advantage of digital opportunities. One good example of the work that our enterprise agencies are already doing is the partnership between Scottish Enterprise, Scotland IS and Smart Exporter to deliver the E-commerce Scotland programme. This provides practical support and ideas for all types of businesses designed to help them grow their online sales both at home and throughout the world.
Brown.
I'm grateful for that answer. According to the Office for National Statistics, total e-commerce sales for the UK reached £492 billion. What is the Scottish Government estimate for annual total e-commerce sales in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Government's assessment, which was contained in the SQW report on Scottish e-commerce, which was published in May 2012, was that e-commerce sales per annum in Scotland totaled £31 billion.
Question number 5, Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how Scotland Food and Drink's new export plan will support Scottish produce abroad.
Cabinet Secretary Richard Lockhead.
I was delighted to launch Scotland's new food and drink export plan in Edinburgh last week at Nairn's Oatcakes in the city.
The plan is a fantastic example of collaboration between the industry and government and will capitalise on the industry's tremendous success by focusing on key export markets over the next 5 years. This will be done by deploying a team of global experts across these markets to open up new opportunities and drive up international sales. I am fully confident this will reap huge rewards for Scotland in the coming years and help the industry meet its new ambitious export target of £7.1 billion by 2017.
Christine McKelvey.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and ask the Cabinet Secretary if he agrees with me that with more effective overseas representation, because we all know the barriers that are put in the way of using UK embassies with Scotland being charged for that, that we can better promote our produce abroad and tackle barriers to trade that are not prioritised by this current Westminster Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's certainly the case that an independent Scotland could certainly do a lot more to increase exports and ensure we're targeting key markets. I recall actually being in Tokyo with Scotland's biggest food and drink mission back in 2012 when the UK Consul General in Tokyo told me that getting Scottish beef into the Japanese market was not a priority, to the alarm and surprise of the Scottish delegation. And of course, Scottish representatives would ensure that getting Scottish beef into the Japanese market was a priority. So that gives one of many examples of how we could be boosted in terms of international export sales with independence.
Question number six, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what assistance is available for homeowners and council tenants when structural defects are identified in their homes.
Minister Margaret Burgess.
Local authorities have a statutory duty to ensure that homes let to their tenants are wind and watertight and otherwise fit for human habitation, and ensure that any work needed to comply with this duty is carried out within a reasonable time. Private homeowners are primarily responsible for work required in their own homes, but the local authority has discretionary powers to provide a broad range of assistance.
Jackie Bailey.
Minister, for that response. The Minister will be aware of up to 90 properties in Silverton and Dumbarton that have unforeseen structural problems, leading to a number of families being decanted. The cost of rectifying the structural problem is beyond many of the homeowners, despite the Council's pledge of assistance. Would the Minister agree to meet with me, the Council, and a small number of residents to explore possible solutions?
Minister.
The situation that the member raises, and I have sympathy with the situation that many members are in, but primarily, you know, the local authority and my officials have already offered to meet with the local authority to look at solutions forward, but I am willing to take up the offer of the member and meet with her and the tenants to hear about their issues.
Question number seven, Drew Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the comment by the European Commissioner for Education that any attempt to treat Scottish and non-Scottish students differently could be regarded as a covert form of discrimination on grounds of nationality.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Russell.
Presiding Officer, I read with great interest the response from Commissioner Vassiliou on 7 February to the question posed by David Martin, MEP. The Commissioner's response makes it clear that it would be possible for an independent Scotland, as part of the EU, to maintain our current policy of enabling universities to charge students in the rest of the UK tuition fees by objectively justifying this position. That is what we have set out on page 199 of Scotland's Future. Our policy approach has been made necessary by the imposition of fees of up to £27,000 over 3 years on students in other parts of the UK. In order to protect places for Scottish domiciled students, we had no option but to take decisive action. Drew Smith is, of course, wrong in his assertion that Scottish and non-Scottish students are treated differently, now or in an independent Scotland. Our policy is one based on residence, not on nationality.
Drew Smith.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Previously, when it's been pointed out that the SNP's plans to discriminate against English students in independent Scotland is illegal under EU law, the Cabinet Secretary has suggested that University Scotland's legal advice backs up his position. So how does he explain the fact that University of Scotland are now publicly calling for robust and legally defensible certainty? Isn't it the case that the group he claimed backed him up are now calling for him to avoid protracted court action, and he is left defending an indefensible policy and a £150 million black hole in university finance?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, all of that is simply not the case. University of Scotland, well, it's simply not the case. I mean, and it doesn't become the case simply because Drew Smith says it's the case. And indeed, it is misleading, I have to say, Presiding Officer, to quote the opinion of Commissioner Vassiliou without quoting all of the opinion of Commissioner Vassiliou, who says, unless justified by objective considerations independent of the nationality of the persons concerned and proportionate to the legitimate aim pursued. He also says in the start of his answer, it is not the role of the Commission to express a position on questions of internal organisation relating to the constitutional arrangements of a particular member state. So I think Commissioner Vassiliou would be unhappy with Mr Smith, as indeed many people would be in University of Scotland, because he has misrepresented their position as well.
Question number 8, Lewis MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government what special measures are being put in place to allow families from the North and North East to attend the League Cup final in Glasgow on Sunday the 16th of March.
Minister Shona Robison.
I can advise that special train services for supporters from Aberdeen and Inverness to Glasgow have been arranged between the clubs and ScotRail, with a significantly reduced fare for children travelling with adults. On the roads, Traffic Scotland will provide a higher level of monitoring on all routes leading to Glasgow. The VMS overhead signs will be used to highlight any delays in queuing traffic on an as-required basis, and the use of all other platforms such as Traffic Scotland Radio, website and Twitter will highlight the increased traffic on the day.
I thank the Minister very much. The Minister will be aware that ScotRail is now indeed filling a third football special from Aberdeen to Glasgow on Sunday, which is very welcome, but also that their reduced fares policy allows a parent to buy a specially priced ticket for only one accompanying child. Will she thank ScotRail for their efforts so far, but ask them to look again at their family tickets policy before the next time Aberdeen fans travel in such large numbers to a cup final in Glasgow, which may not be very long away?
Cabinet Secretary, Minister.
Well, I certainly will thank ScotRail, and of course they'll always keep these issues under review, but can I wish both teams, Caley Thistle and Aberdeen, all the best in what I'm sure will be a good show for Scottish football on Sunday.
Well, can I call the other half, Dave Stewart?
Thank you, President Officer. I share, of course, Mr MacDonald's concerns. And, of course, Sunday will see a modern-day Highland clearance as thousands of Caley Thistle fans decant in Glasgow for a very special day. However, traffic congestion, delays and hold-ups are, of course, a very real worry to many supporters. Does the Minister share the concerns of a young Caley Thistle fan who told me this morning, Caley Thistle may well go ballistic, but the A9 is atrocious?
Minister.
Well, as I said, a lot of work and effort has been put in on both the rail network and the road network to make sure both sets of fans get to the game safely, and I'm sure we will see a great display of football come Sunday.
Question number 9, James Donner.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the economic benefits of independence.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm delighted to provide an economic... The Scottish Government has set out in Scotland's Future and the Economic Choices paper a detailed analysis of the opportunities and benefits of independence. Independence will allow Scotland to use our own resources and to shape our own fiscal and economic policies to meet the needs of the people of Scotland.
James Dornan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. Following the credit rating agency Standard & Poor's citing high-quality human capital, flexible product and labour markets and transparent institutions as reasons for confidence in the Scottish economy, does he agree with me that it is time for opponents of independence to realise that Scotland is wealthy enough to be an independent country, and
Cabinet
that it is time that we use that wealth to improve Scotland rather than sending it to be squandered by the Westminster Treasury in London?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Mr Donner makes a fair and dispassionate point. He's quite right to cite the evidence put forward by Standard & Poor's, who noted that even without North Sea oil and calculating per capita GDP only by looking at onshore income, Scotland would qualify for their highest economic assessment. I think what this demonstrates is what we all know, that Scotland is a strong and wealthy country, able to contribute to the international community and able to deliver an agenda in Scotland which delivers prosperity for our people and tackles the inequality that has been such a hallmark of the United Kingdom.
Yeah. Malcolm Chisholm.
Will the Cabinet Secretary confirm that Scottish spending as a percentage of UK spending was greater last year than Scottish revenues as a percentage of UK revenues? And will he confirm that this has been the case for 17 out of the last 23 years, contrary to the distorted claims of the Yes campaign?
Well, Cabinet Secretary.
What I'm absolutely delighted to confirm to Mr Chisholm is that when we look at the last 5 years of performance...
Order.
Well, when we look at the last 5 years of performance, the percentage of public expenditure in Scotland as a share of GDP in the United Kingdom was 45.4%, and in Scotland it was 44.2%. That deflates the nonsense that Mr Chisholm has just come out with.
We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Joanne Lambert.